serving Youngstown, Akron, and you. We're PBS 45 and 49.
Commercial television became a regular part of our lives in 1948 and quickly rivaled movies as the public's main source of entertainment. Soon, television produced its own stars who were surprised by the power of this new medium.
One day in the subway, a woman came up to me and said, "I would like to thank you for all the laughter you've brought into our house." I've heard that many times since, but that was the first time. And suddenly I realized the power of this medium.
Jerry! I'm going to South America. My show is like wildly popular there. I do actually. We're worldwide.
Currently seen in 144 countries and viewed by more than 1 billion viewers a week. The hit TV series Baywatch.
In the beginning, we got a lot of flack about Baywatch not being real. And I would always point to, "Oh yeah, well watch this."
Right now, you know, it's a shame that this show isn't in color. We're not too sure that it's even in black and white, but that's not your problem.
Gunsmoke was first out of the gate, and it was so successful, within 3 years, you had 35 so-called adult westerns.
She was a special part of my life. And I understood her, and she understood me. And that fiasco on Dallas, which was part of the process of the last year of her life, really, as her son, so angered me.
We didn't realize at the time, when we were doing it, we had no idea that this was changing the face of emergency medicine. We didn't know. We were looking for a job each year. We thought, well, we can't go another year. You know, we better start looking for another job.
It shows you the power of the media. Woman's going by with three dogs. She said, "What are we going to do tonight, Marty?" I said, "I don't know." That was my cue.
What do you feel like doing tonight?
I don't know. What do you feel like doing tonight?
The garbage truck goes by, the guy's waving and said, "What are we going to do tonight, Marty?" I said, "I don't know. What are we going to do tonight?" I went to get my corn muffin and tea, and the guy gives me my tea and corn muffin and says, "What are we going to do tonight, Marty?" I said, "I don't know. What are we going to do?" And then I realized this one-hour show, which was basically about a lonely person, hit a nerve in the country.
I had the chance to be part of the invention of live television in the late 40s. Since I was not under contract to a studio as Paul Newman and Kirk and Bert and the others were, and got to invent television along with about 30 or 40 other largely unemployed 24-year-olds.
In 1947, 1 year before the rest of the U.S. would see television on a regular basis, Los Angeles station KTLA-TV signed on with the legendary Bob Hope, who also made history with the first recorded television blooper.
Well, I want to tell you, it's a great thrill to be here on this wonderful initial program of station KTL. And ladies and gentlemen, this is Bob, first commercial television broadcast Hope, telling you gals who've tuned in, and I want to make this emphatic, if my face isn't handsome and debonair, please blame it on the static. Which one do I look at? All I want to know is which one picks up the smell. Is this one there now?
I did some shows with KTLA. I did Spade Cooley show, Country Western, and then we did a remotes out from the beach, and then I did some commercials for Vandy Camps. I'll never forget, $5 a commercial. How about that, television audience? $5 a commercial at KTLA Paramount.
From Kukla, Fran, and Ollie in Chicago to the Camel News Caravan, Break the Bank, and Howdy Doody Time in New York, the fledgling television schedule was sparse, but the number of viewers grew almost from the very beginning. One of the early performers who played Clarabelle the Clown on Howdy Doody, would later become better known to the world as Captain Kangaroo. Bob Keeshan remembers his career fondly.
Well, it was really quite accidental. I was a page at NBC. In desperation, I guess, Bob asked if I'd like to help out on this program. So I soon created a character called Clarabelle, Clarabelle the Clown. And he became popular, and the writers were writing for him. And soon things happened in television. It just exploded.
Presenting a great howdy-doody spectacle.
Oh, no, spectacular, John.
Presenting a great howdy-doody spectacular.
Say, kids, what time is it?
But television's first big hit would come from an ex-vaudevillian named Milton Berle. As host of Texaco Star Theater, Uncle Milty, as he was fondly known, caused sales of television sets to pass the 1 million mark, earning him the moniker Mr. Television.
Mildred!
You're very wonderful, and let me know where you're working so I'll go and laugh at you. Before I go any further, the girl who catches the lucky bouquet is going to be the next bride. Mother, will you put down your hands?
I saw the poor fish you're married to.
You know, it's so reminiscent. I mean, the nostalgia does something to me. And when you do a running gag like Don't Laugh, Lady, and you know, my mother was in the audience. That was my mother.
Don't laugh, lady. I look like Laurence Olivier. You look like Chop Livia.
She was such an audience. She used to laugh at their questions.
I'm from the days of variety. And when I used to do the Texaco Star Theater with Milton Berle, and then, I mean, that was live. You know, you didn't take a script home and study for 4 or 5 days and then do it. You studied, you rehearsed, and you did it all within 3 days. I was doing the Milton Berle show one time, and Milton Berle ran over. In the beginning, where he came out as the girl and threw things, and they all went wild, and so then came one script, one show. We were ready for one comedy part, and the director came back and says, "We're running over time. You got to change it. So get dressed for the other skits." We changed, made it. Didn't faze us. We did it.
Berle wasn't the only vaudeville veteran to find a niche in television. George Burns, with his partner and wife Gracie Allen, were able to take their act from stage to radio to TV.
I was in show business when I was 8 years old, and I was bad from 8 to 27, but I liked what I was doing. The audiences didn't like me, but that didn't faze me. I had music in my key, I had cards printed, I had pictures. I was ready in case they wanted a book. And I was very lucky in those days. There was a lot of theaters that you could be bad in. I was bad, but there were theaters worse than I was. I had jobs now and then. Then I met Gracie when I was 27, and things happened.
Oh, and then there was a doctor in the next office whistling. And
this doctor was whistling?
Yes, and the nurse said that was Dr. Brown, the famous obstetrician.
I see.
She said that last year he had 260 babies. And I said, well, I bet his wife isn't whistling.
George Burns sat me down in my dressing room and puffed on his big cigar and told me without fanfare that he was hiring my director away from me. I said, why, George? He said, Gracie hasn't been feeling well lately, and I need to take as much anxiety and nervousness away from her as I possibly can. And he said, I'm losing the director we've had all these years, Freddie DeCordova, I believe. Mm-hmm. Freddie has to move on to something else, so I'm taking your director. I said, well, what am I going to do? He said, you don't need him because you have right on your own set a great directorial talent. I said, you mean Eddie Rubin? He said, no. Joe DePue, the assistant director, he said, no. Well, then who? He said, you.
My agent has warned me that you're quite a wolf. Are you a wolf, Mr.?
Now, let's get something straight between us right now. I do not mix my personal and professional lives. You are merely an object to be photographed. And as long as you're in front of this camera, I'm not interested in your name, your address, or your phone number. Is that understood?
Yes, sir.
start with your phone number.
The number of television sets multiplied rapidly, and the new medium found its way into everyone's neighborhood, including that of Fred Rogers, who quickly realized TV's educational potential.
I was at home on Easter vacation, and I did see television at my mother and dad's place, and people were throwing pies at each other on the screen. And I thought, this is too wonderful a medium to waste it on that kind of demeaning behavior. And I was all set to go to the seminary, had applied and been accepted. And I said to my parents, you know, I think I'll try my hand in television. They said, well, you've never even seen it. And I said, I've seen enough of it right here, right now, and I'd like to try it. And so I went to NBC and became a floor manager. But I didn't look at a camera until I was in Canada some years later. And Fred Rainsbury, who was head of children's programming for the CBC, said, I've seen you talk with kids. Let's just try that on the air. And I said, oh, no, Fred. I came up here to do puppets and music. He said, let's just try it. And we'll call it Mr. Rogers, all one word. And I said, well, what do you want me to wear? And he said, oh, something casual. So, I have always isn't it amazing how things, just like you. How things begin?
Could you be mine? Won't you be my neighbor?
The first time I ever saw TV, I guess I was about 16 years old or whatever when we moved to California in 1950. And, of course, the first thing we saw was wrestling.
Another Beal by Leo. Bombs away. There he goes, and the Baron goes outside. Here comes George and takes one to the jaw. Bombs for the George, and he's in the corner staggering.
I sure have recollections of Engineer Bill, on one of the kids' shows that they had on in the afternoon, and boxing, and I still like boxing today. It's kind of interesting. That's all there was on TV in those early days.
He figured he could do some good, to contribute something with this character of Hopalong Cassidy. So he did what nobody else has ever done, and that was to buy the rights to the character that he played. It was William Boyd playing Hopalong Cassidy, but he became Hopalong Cassidy. When the original contract was made with Paramount for the Hoppies, who knew about television? You know, and yet it was in there, and they went on KTLA, late 48, 49, it hit in 50, it was the big year where it exploded. And then, of course, it was the biggest thing that ever happened.
When I first came here to the United States in 51, because it was only radio when I left Canada, and television hadn't started there, you know, in the sense of watching. So my first would have been here in Hollywood, you know, time that I was able to watch it and find out all about it. And I thought, well, I belong in that medium. I really do. I felt that it was home for me, and it always has felt like home to me.
Giselle, as many years as I've had that ball, no one has ever been permitted to go down there with me. I'm terribly sorry, but I...
Oh, Jack, please. Please take me down. I'd love to see you. I wouldn't tell anybody. I wouldn't tell anybody.
Well, I'll tell you what. All right. Yeah, you see, that's an extra precaution that I took. I have three, you know.
Three alligators?
Yes, I had four, but Mary wanted a bag for Christmas.
All those years on the hit parade and with Jack Benny.
Give me A, will you, please?
All right.
I've always felt very at home for me. It's like I'm talking to a friend, or friends in the case of the audience. It's friends.
Friends, this is Television City in Hollywood, where many of your favorite shows originate. This is the main lobby. Here's a group of visitors being shown around the studios.
Why are you always lagging behind?
Didn't you invite me on a tour of this building?
Yeah, but you don't have to stop and gawk at every actor, you see.
So how did I meet you?
Jack Benny, he's a comedian from another school. He's not the more in-your-face that we have today. But just extremely humorous at all times in a very subtle way. And because I had grown up listening to him, you know, that's when everybody gathered in the living room and you sat and looked at the radio. And so when I first worked with him, I could never look at him without laughing.
Bing, look, you think you're having fun. And you know why? Because you're so nervous.
Yikes!
First comic I've carried since Holt. Doing better this season.
Did you have to sneak in on me like that?
I'm sorry.
And every day at 4, we turned the apple boxes upside, and he took his hanky out and put it over, and we had tea and a cigar and some cookies. And Bing Crosby was very humorous as well. They both had wonderful wit, but it just flowed, and you picked it up or you didn't pick it up, you know? But it was never pushed at you. You were never obligated in any way to laugh. Their humor never obligated you.
Anyway, I've had a very bad season, Jack.
Oh, yeah? I'd like to have your money.
I wish you had it. It'd be safer with you.
You said it.
It was there for you to enjoy if you wanted it, and if you didn't, that was fine, too. We just moved right along.
Radio's most popular stars, Jack Benny, Bob Hope, Arthur Godfrey, and Red Skelton, were just a few of the many performers able to transfer their success from radio over to television.
And now, here's that man himself, Arthur Godfrey.
When we first went to New York, we went to CBS and auditioned for the Arthur Godfrey Talent Scout Show. He was away on vacation. And we thought, well, that means don't call us, we'll call you, because they said they did want us on the first show when he returned.
Hi. Gee, it's nice to see you all again.
He was a joy to work for. He expected you to work and to come up with new songs and all that, but he was very fair. He rented Madison Square Garden for us to learn ice skating. We learned to horseback ride on his farm in Leesburg. He was the first with locational shows in Florida, Cheyenne, Wyoming, Lake Placid, New York, Coney Island. And he was exciting. Exciting person to work for, very creative.
The late 1940s was the springboard for television's universal popularity in the next decade. Back to the 50s, when television the first 50 years continues.
Hi, I'm Mike Wallace with a sensational shortening discovery for better baking and frying. It's Procter & Gamble's Golden Fluffo. Richer looking, better tasting, more appetizing. But let's hear what Mrs. Thelma Styra, Indiana State Fair baking champion, had to say about Fluffo.
I love Fluffo. It makes such a golden brown pie.
Oh, man, that's some apple pie.
Well, Mr. Wallace, that's a prettier pie than I ever baked with plain white shortening. And look how flaky it is. This yellow Fluffo is such a short shortening, makes pie crust so rich.
Like cooking champions, get richer looking, better tasting, more appetizing results in everything you bake or fry.
The 1950s was arguably television's golden age, with an incredible number of shows, now considered classics, debuting within that decade. The list is almost endless, as are the stories from the creative people who brought these shows to life. Of course, the influential and historically important I Love Lucy tops the list.
Wow.
Well, radio was 48, 49, 50, and then suddenly television came in, and we did Lucy's radio show called My Favorite Husband.
Hello, Kay.
Oh, Lucy, oh, boy. I adore you. I worship you. Oh, every beat of my heart is a flame that burns your name in my soul.
Okay, Kay, don't be ridiculous. Well, you just met me.
Hey, listen, a chowhound doesn't have to wait for dinner to be hungry, you know.
CBS wanted her to come in to television with that property. Lucy said, no, I want to go on television with my husband. And we said, whoever that is. He was on the road, Desi Arnaz, singing what? Baba what?
And she wanted them to work together. He was always gone, and she was doing things at Metro, and they never got to see each other, really. They was, you know, their hours were terrible.
They would meet each other up in Mulholland. He was coming back from the nightclub at 4 o'clock. She was on the way to the studio for makeup at 4 o'clock. I guess they'd meet up on the, you know, hug and kiss up in Mulholland Drive. So she insisted, thank goodness she insisted. You know, we got this great Cuban.
The impact of the show was certainly very powerful for people coming to this country. The impact was there immediately that they knew of the I Love Lucy show, and they actually identified with Dad sometimes more than Mom, the people from Cuba. But there were people that Dad discovered and put on the show that did very well, and also people who worked at Desilu Studios.
CBS was very reluctant. They said, who'll believe you're married to this Cuban? She said, well, I am married to this Cuban. And so Bob and I wrote a nightclub act for them, and they went out on the road to show how they could work together. And that became the basis, really, for I Love Lucy, where she was the tramp who played the cello, the clown. And, of course, the audiences loved them. And she, by then, she always was a clown, but they didn't have a place for her in the movies like that. She did comedies, but they were those kind of wisecracking, who was funny kind of comedies, or she was a showgirl.
And we were blessed with great performers. Desi was underestimated as a comedy person. And of course, Viv and Bill were magnificent.
Well, we used to use everything that would happen to our friends and to us, because we had a theory that if people would say, that happened to me, then they would really go along with you, and then we would take it to extremes. We had a lot of people say, oh, I did the same thing. When she was pregnant, you know, people would say, that happened to me when I was pregnant.
Ricky, this is it.
City. 450 square miles of it, 150,000 acres, a big place. 6,000 miles of streets, 2 million people. In my job, you get a chance to meet them all. I'm a cop.
Originally one of radio's most popular dramas, Dragnet made a successful transition to television in 1951. Series creator Jack Webb also starred as Sergeant Joe Friday, whose monotone delivery and by-the-book attitude quickly made him a cultural icon.
It was Tuesday, November 15th. It was cold in Los Angeles. We'd been working the early watch out of Central Division, Detective Bureau. I got an emergency call to check back in at the office. An entire block in the heart of the city was facing sudden total destruction. We had 26 minutes to try and stop it. This is the story of those 26 minutes.
In 1954, when television started to really come in, the very first television show I did was Dragnet with Jack Webb. And, you know, I was used to learning my lines and giving a performance, but Jack Webb used teleprompters off camera, and you would read your dialogue right off the teleprompter. That's how he got that, yes, ma'am, how much, ma'am, yes, ma'am, we'll do that, ma'am, because the actors read all the lines, and it seemed so... Well, you know the effect it had, if you remember Dragnet.
MCA-TV proudly presents the most highly honored dramatic series in the history of television.
I did Dragnet for 5 years with Jack, and you know, it was a good show because we only worked like 2 days a week. And Jack insisted on using teleprompters, so you never had to learn the lines. So one of the easiest shows I ever had. Fantastic.
And now, Mr. Jack Webb.
There are over 5,000 men in this city.
who know that being a policeman is an endless, glamorous, thankless job that's got to be done. I know it, too. And I'm damn glad to be one of them.
Kenny, let's have some news. It's about that time.
Come on, Dad.
You can watch that show some other time. Okay. Thanks.
Television's influence on public opinion was truly felt when the medium's premier journalist, Edward R. Murrow, attacked Senator Joseph McCarthy and single-handedly ended the communist witch hunts and the senator's career.
But the line between investigating and persecuting is a very fine one, and the junior senator from Wisconsin has stepped over it repeatedly. His primary achievement has been in confusing the public mind as between the internal and the external threats of communism.
Mr. Chairman, now I just give this man's record.
Senator, may we not drop this? Have you no sense of decency, sir, at long last? Have you left no sense of decency?
You brought him down, did you not, to act as your assistant?
Mr. McCarthy, if there is a God in heaven, it will do neither you nor your cause any good. I will not discuss it further. You, Mr. Chairman, may, if you will, call the next witness.
The actions of the junior senator from Wisconsin have caused alarm and dismay amongst our allies abroad and given considerable comfort to our enemies. And whose fault is that? Not really his. He didn't create this situation of fear. He merely exploited it, and rather successfully. Cassius was right. The fault, dear Brutus, is not in our stars, but in ourselves.
I'm sometimes asked who was the most impressive person you ever met, and I have to say it was Ed Murrow, my boss and mentor, Edward R. Murrow. He disliked injustice so much that he had to get involved. So I think Murrow by far was the greatest.
From news to variety, television executives in the 50s were inventing what they thought the public wanted to see. And most of the time, they were correct.
Dean is definitely the funniest of the two. To define that a little more precisely, he had the wit. He was always dropping very witty things. Never obligated you again, never pushed it, never in your face, but it was always there, and my ear was always tuned out. What'd he say? Because it was always something, a little jewel, you know. Whereas Jerry, you know, you were lucky to survive the day without having your clothes ripped and your foot stamped and your, you know, it was total bedlam. I only went to lunch with Jerry Lewis once because when we came in, he first tossed coins in the water that the girl was trying to pour, then he picked up the salt shaker and all poured down. He said, I got a terrible cold today. And it just kept going on like that until the table was turned upside down, the food was all over the floor. I didn't know if I had eaten, what I had eaten. And every time after that, when Jerry would talk about lunch, I always found something else that was terribly, terribly important for me to take care of at that time.
I'm telling Jerry what I would like him to do. I said, now you go around the table to the hole opposite the one that Dean is using. And I looked up on the stage, the two of them with their arms folded were looking at me. Not with no expressions whatsoever. Then I said, Jerry, it's been raining out, so you lean over, and as you lean over the hole by you, the water goes in that hole and comes up on the other hole into Dean's face. And I look up on the stage, nothing. And then I said, Jerry, I want you to go, and they both of them jumped off the stage, picked me up bodily, and took me down to Hollywood and Vine. I'll never forget the Broadway Hollywood is there. Took off all my clothes in the middle of the street. And in those days, we wore boxers. That's all I was left with, was the boxer shorts. And 1,000 people now had gathered around, and policemen. And there I am in the middle of the street. They got up and went back to the theater.
We'd like you to remember, don't forget your contributions to the New York Heart Hospital. You've been
every night of the week was dominated by a particular program or personality.
God bless you all.
Sunday nights belonged to the Colgate Comedy Hour and the toast of the town, Ed Sullivan.
There are a lot of celebrities. In our show in New York, we have made a feature of introducing celebrities in the audience. And it brings into homes the faces of people that they're acquainted with. It sort of amplifies the whole scope of the show. Sitting out here tonight is one of the great stars of Hollywood, Dick Powell. Dick, where are you seated? Dick, can you stand up there and take a bow? Hiya, Richard.
Hey, Chippy, Chikey, Chucky, I want to sign you to do my show. You hear what I tell you? And I signed with Sullivan. I signed with Sullivan to do 12 shots. I got into New York the first time. I got on stage, and he says, you're in my territory now. I'm not in the enemy camp. Chicky, chikey, chucky. And he treated me like I did something wrong to him. What happened was all the agencies, which I didn't have at that time, convinced him I was getting too much money from him, even before I started working, you know. But through the years, we had many stories about Sullivan. I had a situation once where he cut my act from 8 minutes to 2 minutes, and I did a thing taking the microphone apart, and I turned the microphone upside down, and I talked to miners that were buried. It was just a routine. But at the same time I was doing that, and this was a live show, I didn't realize that a mine disaster in Nova Scotia. So now, as I'm walking off the stage, he's, you sick, dirty noggin, he started violently swearing at me, and I said, what happened? You did that intentionally, you sicky. You're sicky than Lenny Bruce. You're really a sicky. Now, I still didn't know what he was talking about. I got off the stage, and Marlo Lewis, who was his producer at that time, says, why'd you do that? I said, well, tell me what's happening here. And at the very same time I was doing it, they were having this mine disaster. So he always accused me, and every time he would see me, he would turn to Sylvia, his wife, and say, Sylvia, why do we dislike Shecky Green? She said, the mine disaster. Oh, yeah, that's right. He would run. But near the end, we became very, very close friends, because he forgot, by that time he was a little bit into dementia, and he forgot about his show, forgot about the mine disaster, you know. So we used to go to dinner a lot.
The Ed Sullivan Show was undoubtedly one of the big highlights of my and my wife Ann Mira's life. We were given an opportunity to be great in front of a national audience. We were given one chance, and for whatever reason that Ed Sullivan saw, he kept bringing us back. And he established this as a comedy team known as Stiller and Mara. And Mara, of course, was the Irish pronunciation of Mira. And during our entire time with Ed Sullivan, we never bothered to correct him because he wanted it that way. He was a guy who saw things a certain way. He was a beautiful person in a lot of ways. He was fearless. He was generous. He was forgiving, and he was unpredictable. All of those things in one. And if you could kind of live through all of those moments, it ends up in one big, I call it a love burst or whatever it is. Because I look back on it now, I says, if not for him, I mean, I could never have done other things.
Oh, you know, when we did the Sullivan Show with the Beatles, it was February 9th, 1964. It was absolute pandemonium. So we're in the wings, and I'm trying to figure, what the hell are we going to do? They're not even going to hear a joke. You know, and I'm telling Marty, when Sullivan introduces us, you know, we better just go into a Beatles song. Marty says, well, we got to do the routine. I said, there's no way they're going to hear a joke. So these kids are screaming. And you could just barely hear Sullivan, Alan and Rossi, you know. So we go out there, and Marty says, hello there, I'm Ringo's mother, right? So the kids started screaming at that point even more. So we won them over, and that was the first time that any act ever went into the audience. Of course, they weren't even prepared for it. They were big cameras all around, you know. And we went out in the audience, and luckily our rhythm section was there, and my conductor. So I started, I want to hold your hand. I'm shaking hands with people, and Marty is. Well, that's all we did was repeat what the Beatles sang, you know, that one particular song, and we were a tremendous hit. Then we went back on the show again, because a lot of people didn't realize it, but the Beatles were on the Sullivan Show three times, not just once. They remember the first one. We also did a show from the Deauville Hotel in Miami. And it was, and they piped in the orchestra, the Ray Black Orchestra, from another room because all the kids were in the ballroom there. And there was no room for the orchestra. So Salvin says, I want you to open up with Granada because those kids are going to love you. I said, they're not even going to hear me. I mean, it's ridiculous. So anyhow, he says, all right, Steve Rossi, you can just barely hear me, and I'm hearing the music piped in from another room, and I'm going, mi cantare, chude fanta, and as I'm singing, these kids are going, boo, you stink.
When you're smiling,
Frank Sinatra was, in his own way, an inspiration to us, which was a spectacular way because we always admired his breath control and his choice of material, his orchestrators. And when Frank was just getting over or trying to get over Ava, and he had his ups and downs, as you well know, he had a show on CBS in the early years of CBS, and it was sponsored by Chesterfield, and he was just going to smoke and sing. And at that particular time, it didn't work that well for him, so he called in hot stars, because at that time he wasn't hot, to help him out. And I remember that that's when we first met Frank. It was in the 50s.
When you're smiling.
Well, it was a big show for television, and it was Anything Goes. And Frank was sort of doing a little comeback, and I was very hot at the time. So we did a lot of publicity together to sort of get Frank back in the picture, you know. And Ethel Merman was in it, and Bert Lahr. And it was, you know, a big deal for television. And Frank was so thin. When Anything Goes, he gets put in jail, and he sings in the still of the night. He leaned on the bars, and he walked right through them. So they had to redo all the bars. And they said, well, you know, it's a standard bar. They said, well, whatever it is, he's getting out. So they had to redo the whole set and squeeze them all together.
Your coffee, Mr. Gleason.
Thank you. How sweet it is. Thank you.
You're welcome.
You know, 38 weeks might not be long enough, I'll tell you that. Ladies and gentlemen, we've got a long show. We want to get it all in, so Sam, a little traveling music.
He was a great comedian, dramatic actor, writer, conductor of his own orchestra, songwriter, and dancer.
And away we go. Hey!
The characters he developed were legendary.
Give me a shot of Moxie.
Jackie Gleason was the ultimate entertainer. He was called the Great One for good reason. There was nothing he couldn't do.
Got another thing in here, an article about pay TV. What do you think of pay TV, Mr. Dunahy? No. You got it wrong. They don't pay you to watch TV. You pay to watch it. You don't think they'll go for it. Well, I think you're wrong, Mr. Dunahy. Well, let's ask an average man. Crazy Guggenheim's in the back. I'll call him out. Hey, Crazy, come out here.
Hi, Joe. Hello, Mr. Dunahy.
This is the average man, Mr. Dunahy.
Another legendary funny man was Red Skelton, who ably mixed pathos with slapstick.
Never be a success. There's too many moving parts.
Dead eye.
I haven't seen you in quite a while.
Yeah, that's because I ain't wearing that dress. Say, gal. Why don't you and me go for a little ride out on the range tonight?
Well, why the range?
Why, because out there seldom is heard a discouraging word.
The Western genre thrived in early television, and programs like The Lone Ranger were a hit among the kids.
The Lone Ranger, presented by Tootsie Roll.
Are you still there?
A fiery horse with the speed of light, a cloud of dust, and a hearty Hi-Yo Silver. The Lone Ranger.
Radio was the source of many of TV's early westerns, including the first adult western, Gunsmoke.
Jim and I had worked this kind of relationship out very carefully right at the very beginning of the show. We knew just exactly what we wanted to do with it. And we wanted to leave the relationship a mystery so that the audience could use their own imagination and do their own fantasies on what the relationship was really all about. And needless to say, that was one of the ingredients that made Gunsmoke a success.
I didn't think you were ever going to get
this. This saloon been open all night?
Yeah, of course it has.
Well, you know, there's an ordinance against that.
Well, yeah, I know there is. But you see, I have a real big influence with the marshal in this town.
Jim Arness, although he doesn't seem like it when you see him on film because he's playing a certain character that's in control and rather stern and serious, he's the funniest guy I was ever around.
The great Marshal Dillon, as we have known him for 19 years.
There was always a lot of laughs on that show. We'd break each other up, and it's very difficult to get through scenes sometimes.
Just your fork and get it there and push it down into the meat so that you got a good hold to it. And then just run your knife down. That's all you have to do. Kind of sawing away there. Yeah, that's... You're doing fine now. I mean... Am I?
Well, with that, see, I got a mouthful, too.
There were a number of people that tested for Chester. Guy Williams was one of them, who was a good friend of mine at the time. He later played Zorro. You'd think, well, what is he doing testing for Chester? But anyway, he did, and I remember they, you know, you have to sign a contract about the money before you test, because they don't want to be in the position of wanting you and not having a contract. So they offered me $300 a week for the part, and I thought, well, and I didn't have an agent at the time. I was in between agents, so I called up Guy Williams, and I said, Guy, I understand that you tested for Chester. He says, yeah. I said, what did they offer you? He said, $400. So I went back to him, and I said, I'm sorry, I can't do this for less than $400. This is okay. So I got $400 a week in the beginning, playing Chester.
This was about 1954. I was under contract to him for about 2 years with Bat Jack Company. Mm-hmm. And I'd been in two or three pictures with him. I guess they offered Gunsmoke to him first, or they asked him if he'd be interested, and you know, obviously he wasn't. He was pretty busy doing what he was doing in features, you know. He recommended me for it, and went over there, and I think he put in a real pitch for me, and because, you know, I don't know if you remember then, but they were testing a heck of a lot of guys for it, all kinds of different people for the part, everybody in town, practically, you know. And I'm sure that it was his influence that probably tipped it my way, you see.
Gunsmoke was first out of the gate. And it was so successful, within 3 years, you had 35 so-called adult westerns. Everybody from Steve McQueen to Jim Garner to Bonanza, all of those shows were on the air because of Gunsmoke.
Late 50s television spawned other westerns to rival Gunsmoke's success.
Wagon Train was an exceptional show. If most of the viewers will probably remember that in the early days of television, when Wagon Train was a hit, it was the highest rated show on the air. It was pulling a 50 share every Wednesday evening. during the Ward Bond days and the John McIntyre days. My recollections of Wagon Train are great because my dressing room when I was doing Laramie was right beside Ward Bond, Frankie McGrath, and Terry Wilson, who played Hawks, and Wooster, the cook. And we used to play cards together, and we were good friends. I didn't get along with Ward Bond because I had guested on a couple of Wagon Trains before I started Laramie, and he wasn't very nice to me, and so I didn't pay much attention to him. And I, when Laramie ended, he had passed away, and John McIntyre, who was a dear friend of mine and had done many Laramies, had taken over as the wagon master. And when they asked me if I would like to go on as the scout, I was thrilled, of course. You know, a chance to work, you know, side by side with John again. And Frankie and Terry, of course, who were still there. Wagon Train was the type of show that used huge guest stars. And that was an opportunity for me. I mean, I worked with people like Robert Ryan, had love scenes with Rhonda Fleming, you know, which incredible situations like that. So that was quite a thrill. Back in, well, the 60s, there were 32 Westerns in prime time television. That's hard to believe, but it's very true. I was just looking at an old TV guide of mine from Laramie, and I just happened to thumb through it on every page. There's three or four Westerns that night. It's kind of interesting, and they had a message. They really did.
Here, gun to kill bad men.
I'm not going to do any killing.
You'll not defend yourself?
Oh, I'll shoot if I have to. But I'll shoot the wound, not to kill. A man must die. It's up to the law to decide that. Not the person behind a six-shooter.
That's right, Kemosabe.
The Rifleman.
I think there was a good hero in most of those Westerns for kids growing up. I don't see that in television very much today.
I was very proud to be chosen to play him, and it had a lot of life to it because the man had a long life. And I read a great deal about him, and I chose to portray him the way I think that he actually lived, and a very exciting character.
Westerns, they had an enormous influence on me. I certainly didn't want to be an actor, but I might have wanted to be a cowboy.
I loved television. I loved it. Roy and I did the Roy Rogers Day 11 show in 1960 on NBC for Quaker Oats and later Nestle's Chocolate and a few others. I'll never forget that. It was hard because I had a house full of children, you know, trying to be a mother and trying to be on location at 7 o'clock in the morning because, you know, we were all outdoors always with Roy Trigger and Buttermilk and Pat Brady and the Jeep, Nellie Bell, you know, but it was fun. And I loved it, I enjoyed it. And of course, sometimes it's hard. Of course, since I lost Roy, you know, to see it. It's been a long, long trail, very long. It's been wonderful.
The Western will be back. The American Cowboy is a legend, and I'm proud to be one of them.
Steve Allen, Tony Randall, producer George Schlatter, Robert Stack, Eric Estrada.
Hey, come on over.
Dick Van Patten and many others. They're all ahead when television, the first 50 years, continues.
The new 1951 Shelvador, the world's most convenient refrigerator.
Crosley's new Carefree automatic defrosting system gives you new luxury, new freedom from messy, old-fashioned defrosting methods. And in addition, you get all the wonderful features of Shelvador design. Plenty of room for ice cubes and frozen foods. Shelves fully recessed in the door give you more space at the convenience level. You'll love Shelvador's new soft glow interior, too.
The quiz show had been a format that was successful on radio and soon flourished on television as well. But not all TV game shows were stepchildren of radio. There were many original ideas developed for 1950s era television game shows, most of them the creations of producers Mark Goodson and Bill Totten.
What's my line? To tell the truth, I've got a secret. We're all produced by Goodson and Totten. And I was saying to someone just today that the panelists were chosen for their own unique and individual qualities. It's different now on panel shows. You can hardly tell one from the other. But I was the sweetness, Henry was the spice, you know, and Bill was Joe College, and Janie Meadows had her wonderful earrings and things, and then, of course, there was darling Gary Moore. But that was true, Arlene Francis and Dorothy Kilgallen and Bennett Cerf.
One of the most popular was What's My Line, where panelists guessed the occupations of contestants. And while blindfolded, guessed the identity of celebrity guests. The regular panelists included Random House publisher and syndicated columnist Bennett Cerf, actress Arlene Francis, syndicated newspaper columnist Dorothy Kilgallen, and the multi-talented comedian, pianist, songwriter, and original Tonight Show host, Steve Allen.
We sometimes think that the only good ones were in the 1950s, and if we think that, we're mistaken. There were good ones then. The Lucy Show was great, and the Honeymooners were great. I think the Dick Van Dyke Show was at the 50s or 60s. Anyway, there were several fine ones in those days, but most of the sitcoms of the 50s were awful. They were for 10-year-old children, and often when 50-year-old people remember them fondly, it's because they liked them when they were 10.
That your locker, young man?
Yes, sir, I have it.
Television made Steve Allen's name a household word, as it did for megastar and TV icon Tony Randall.
Wonderful. You look top drawer.
Though television made him independently wealthy, Randall initially turned down the opportunity to appear on his first series, Mr. Peepers, starring the late Wally Cox. Tony's benefactor was producer Fred Coe.
I landed on a show called Mr. Peepers.
That's me.
And the producer of it was the daddy of television. He was the daddy of all of us, and that was Fred Coe. He had about 15 shows on the air. He really invented this thing called television. And every camera move, every lighting device, everything that was television, Fred Coe did first. Books should be written about that man. He was a true pioneer. One of the greats.
Fred Coe, who was the head of the whole outfit as far as Goodyear and Philco were concerned, and probably, in my opinion, the most talented person who hit television. Fred Coe spoke with a southern accent. He said, I got nothing for next Sunday. What are you doing? We got to do something. And Paddy Chayefsky, who was a friend of his, was there visiting. And he said, Paddy, you got something? You got to have something for me. And Paddy said, well, I don't know. I'm writing a thing about a butcher in the Bronx, a lonely guy. He said, We'll do it.
No. What do you feel like doing tonight? I don't know. What do you feel like doing tonight?
We did it, and I remember I went to Nancy Marchand's dressing room, who played the girl, who she was taller than me and everything, and I said, that was pretty good, huh? She said, yeah, I'll see you. She said, I'll see you, you know, go look for another job. And then next morning I got up. It shows you the power of the media. Woman's going by with three dogs. She said, what are we going to do tonight, Marty? I said, I don't know. That was my cue, right? I don't know. What are we going to do tonight? The garbage truck goes by. The guy's waving and said, what are we going to do tonight, Marty? I said, I don't know. What are we going to do tonight? I went to get my corn muffin and tea, and the guy gives me my tea and corn muffin and says, what are we going to do tonight, Marty? I said, I don't know. What are we going to do? And then I realized this one-hour show, which was basically about a lonely person, hit a nerve in the country.
At that time, I was as interested in directing as I was in acting, anything that I could turn my hand to and keep busy and make a buck. And I had directed a show off Broadway, a little opera called Down in the Valley by Kurt Weill. A lovely, lovely little thing. And it was a success. And that is, it ran. It didn't make any money, but it ran. And now it was going to tour a little bit. And so I was very busy with that when I accepted the job on Mr. Peepers. And then I realized that I was too busy. I couldn't do both. So I called Fredco's office and asked to be let out. And they wouldn't let me out. And that was the luckiest break of my life.
Can I give you a hand?
No.
I'm just going down the hall to get a drink of water.
Oh, no, you're thirsty.
Check.
Suddenly, I was known. As I walked down the street, I was known. I began to get important roles on Broadway. And when we opened in Philadelphia in Inherit the Wind, the star was Paul Muni, one of the greatest stars that the American stage and screens ever had. Of course, when he came on, there was tremendous applause. And when I came on, it was almost the same. And I was stunned. I didn't know that they knew me outside of New York. They knew me in Philadelphia. And the Variety Review mentioned that that's the power of television.
Daytime soap operas also debuted in the early 1950s and maintain their popularity to this day.
That's the closest thing to theater, a soap opera, because you're doing a beginning, a middle, and an end of a scene. You're not doing a film, you're doing the middle and the beginning at the end and the end at the beginning. That can drive you crazy because you don't know exactly where you're going. I'm not a giant fan of filmmaking. I'm a giant fan of television.
I was walking down the street going back to my apartment, and this lovely black lady was walking towards me. And as she got closer and closer to me, her eyes got bigger and bigger and bigger, and I thought, does she think I'm going to do something to her? And suddenly she stopped and she said, excuse me. She said, are you in the stories? And I said, yes. She said, are you on As the World Turns? And I said, yes. She started to, I thought she was going to faint.
The nice thing about doing a soap opera is that you don't have to audition. And if you're lucky, it goes on for years and years and years and years, and you can have your life and your family and also a career that's stable. You have the same parking space, the same phone number. The bad part is that you have a career that goes on and on and on, and you have the same phone number and the same parking place. And a certain kind of actor needs that, and I love it. I love having a home where I work.
The decade of the 1950s also allowed television to offer plenty of variety.
Wasn't I a nasty character?
From Lawrence Welk's long-running Bubble Machine and Rod Serling's Twilight Zone to comedies like
The Adventures of Ozzie and Harriet.
Starting in 1952, Ozzie and Harriet ran until 1966 and detailed the daily adventures of the Nelsons and their two sons.
Yes, they did. Thank you.
Thanks again for the corsage and the champagne.
Oh, this is Miss Nelson, my wife.
I'm your wife.
Yes, of course, this is my wife,
Harriet.
Harriet.
The power of the medium was felt when Ricky Nelson began regularly performing his rock and roll songs on the show. Record sales immediately skyrocketed, and Ricky became a teen idol. Other shows centering around daily family life followed, including Father Knows Best and Dobie Gillis.
All the characters were very rich, you know, and cliche characters. There was the crabby father, there was the eccentric friend, Maynard, there was the bright girl, Sheila James. There was the rich boy, first Milton Armitage. Warren Beatty played that, and then he left to go do movies. And we had Steve Franken as Chatsworth Osborne Jr., but even the rich boy, you know, everybody was right on the nose and a character.
The decade of 1950.
Thomas Show, starring Danny Thomas.
As time passed and new shows appeared, producers realized that family members did not have to be regular people. A man's wife could be a genie. And your favorite uncle could be My Favorite Martian. Ray Walston recalls playing a visitor from outer space.
I wouldn't do My Favorite Martian, for one thing. No, I absolutely would stay away from it entirely, because when you go into the living room of someone's home once a week for a period of 3 years, and we ran 3 years, we should have run eight, but we only ran three. But when you do that, it is really, really tough to shake that image.
Be careful, Beaver. Where am I now, Whitey? Pull yourself up, Beaver. Put your foot on the lady's thumb.
Normal families would still be popular, and one of the most fondly remembered were the Cleavers from the hit show Leave It to Beaver.
The man who created the Donna Reed Show also wrote Magnificent Seven, William Roberts. This is no small credit. Donna Reed was already an Academy Award-winning actress. We had several Academy Award-winning directors, people like Jackie Cooper. We had Emmy-winning people there directing Barry Scheer, the show, who knew what they were doing. She was an amazing woman, as much for her professional skills as for the real character of the woman.
Mr. Disney once said to me, you know, this will be the greatest thing you've ever done in your entire life. Well, when you say that to a 12-year-old, you go, where is this guy coming from?
Two actors who worked for Disney when they were youngsters include Doreen Tracy and Tommy Kirk.
The Hardy Boys ran how many episodes? Let's see, I think it was about, there were two series. One was The Mystery of the Applegate Treasure, that was 15 episodes, and The Mystery of the Ghost Farm, that was 22 episodes. And you know, the reason the writing was so good, it was written by Jackson Gillis, who wrote all the Columbos.
He understood what television was going to become, and he knew what we were representing. The baby boom generation was coming along, and this was guiding them into the 21st century.
Another of radio's most popular programs and hosts made the move to television with Art Linkletter's House Party.
And now here's the star of our show.
In spite of the success he and House Party enjoyed for years, Mr. Linkletter actually yearned to do something totally different, but was never allowed to change.
I always wanted to be on 60 Minutes. And I knew Bill Paley well because I was one of his mainstays in the daytime, and he was a good friend of mine. But he said, Art, I can't move you over to 60 Minutes. Because number one, you're an entertainer, and that's all news. And there's an iron curtain between news and entertainment in those days. Iron curtain. Mike Wallace had to quit being a game show guy and going back to being a junior in the news department while he was cleansed.
And you decide next week what you're going to do. You come back and tell us if you're going ahead and try for the $100,000 question next
Mike.
Week.
What have we got to lose?
Go.
I'll see you next week. Mark,
TV money.
Bye-bye.
Good, but I always wanted to do what Mike Wallace did.
Lucille Ball remained a fixture on TV well into the 60s and 70s with shows like I Love Lucy, The Lucy Show, and Here's Lucy, earning her the name the First Lady of Television. She was also active behind the scenes with the production company she formed with husband Desi Arnaz called Desi Lou.
Well, hello there. Oh, these are some of the actors from our little theater group. Kids? See, we're doing another review in here soon, right here in our little theater. I think you better get in and get to rehearsing. I'll be right in. Here in our Desi Lou workshop, we have paid audiences. As I feel, a paying audience is a more demanding audience. It's a very little theater, but I think it's better for the kids to have a paid audience. You see, I got my first start here on this theater when the studio belonged to RKO, and Ginger Rogers' mother was our coach. And I never forgot how helpful it was to me. So when Desi and I took over the studio, Desi gave me permission to reactivate the little theater. And our first presentation was the Desi Lou Review, and we're all very grateful for the way it was received. And right now, I have to go to stage 9, where they're shooting The Untouchables.
In October 1959, Desi Lou made the name Elliot Ness known to millions when Robert Stack debuted as the Chicago Treasury agent out to nab Al Capone on The Untouchables.
The Untouchables is a very strange kind of a show, and it caught everybody by surprise. And when we won 6 Academy nominations in the first year, it built ABC, and What it proved was that America loves heroes. The biggest flattery I ever had about that was two actors, John Belushi, God bless him, he's no longer with us, and Dan Aykroyd. And they said, you know, when we were kids, you were the man. And our families went around, and you were the guy who went out and got the bad guys. And I said, the guy with the hat. He said, boy, I tell you, you know, when I play with you in a scene now, you still scare hell out of me.
The show caused an awful big hubbub with the Italian people because of the Italian names on the show, like Capone and Frank Nitti. While we were shooting the show, we got a phone call on the set. Now, this is a true story. And our assistant director, Bob Daly, picked up the phone. And it was a woman's voice. And she said, is this the Untouchable? Italian lady. And he said, yes, ma'am. She said, my name is Mrs. Ponticello. I'm the secretary of the Italian-American Federation. All the time on your show, the Untouchables, you show Italian people are bad people, shoot, to fight, to kill. So Italian people, are we not like that? Do we like to eat? Do we like to dance? Do we like to sing? If you don't stop showing Italian people are bad people on your show, somebody going to throw a bomb in your studio.
The Untouchables, a Desilu production.
The innocence of the 50s marched into the 60s with many new shows, including The Dick Van Dyke Show, The Beverly Hillbillies, Petticoat Junction.
Lots of curves, you bet, and even more when you get to the junction.
Petticoat Junction.
And Perry Mason.
I grew up in a town that got television very late due to a fight over the local license, and I grew up listening to radio, even though I'm young enough to have grown up watching television. I grew up on radio and the movies. And my dad then put off buying a set because he kept saying, they're going to get color, you know, we got to wait for color. And so I missed out. You know, I go to school and everybody would be talking about Gunsmoke and Sid Caesar, and I really felt like the parade was passing me by. Then eventually we finally got the set.
Almost every household in the nation had a television set by 1960. As the number of television viewers grew, producers and networks needed to grow too. Movie studios that had previously seen television as an enemy finally began to see the profitable advantages of working in the media. Warner Brothers in particular created new programming and helped make floundering network ABC into one of the big three.
Warner Brothers television production.
77 Sunset Strip.
Starring Ephraim Zimbalist Jr.
77.
I was one of the first young guys on television, and it was a great character. A lot of people remember it, which I'm very grateful to. And when I talk about it, it's almost like it never happened to me. And that's so long ago. I think the combination of the characters, we all got along great. Ephraim Zimbalist, myself, Roger Smith, and we all had the chemistry, and it was a fun show. Nobody took it seriously.
Produced by Warner Brothers.
Anne Francis starred as another popular private eye, Honey West.
The producers on the show approached me one day, and he said, Anne, he said, you know, about your walk. I said, what? You know, he said, well, he said, you don't really wiggle when you walk. I said, no, I don't. And he said, well, you know, if you just, and I said, now, wait a minute. I'm not going to get involved with this kind of thinking of worrying about swaying hips and doing the whole, no way.
I thought the Ed Show would be a hit, but I never thought it would take over my life the way it has. But that's fine, my life isn't over, I'm doing other things, so I'm never surprised by anything anymore in this business. Ed died in 1973. Money was paid to put him on the ranch, where he was taken care of by the trainer, Lester Hilton, who also retired after the Ed Show. And he lived there, and I used to ride him every morning. And then he passed on in 73, and that was that.
Tell him we sent you.
From the talking horse of Mr. Ed to the inept Navy men of McHale's Navy, anything could be a subject for a sitcom in the 60s. And more movie stars made the move to TV, like Academy Award winner Ernest Borgnine.
Remember, folks, being blue is for the birds. Join a happy crew.
Now hear this. This is your military governor speaking. I want you out of my jeep. And the ammo. Otto.
Fred McMurray was another movie star who moved to television and completely changed his image as the star of My Three Sons.
I came on to My Three Sons. The show was already a pretty successful show. I came on in the fourth season, so it was a great opportunity, and it was, you know, a show that was already established as a hit, and to get to work with people like Fred McMurray and Mike Demarest and Wayne Thrawley, you know, they were already big stars for many, many years before that. So, you know, I saw it as a real opportunity, and turned out to be a great experience.
Just sit right back and you'll hear a tale.
Though ravaged by the critics, Gilligan's Island delighted audiences with old-fashioned slapstick comedy, especially from Gilligan and the Skipper, played by Bob Denver and Alan Hale Jr. Those castaways will always be stranded on that island. For every minute of the day, somewhere in the world, an episode of Gilligan's Island is being aired on TV.
A 3-hour tour.
The Here's Johnny happened the very first day. I was thinking all day, what will I do to make this different? I didn't want to say, here's Johnny Carson. It didn't seem like enough, but I didn't have the right kickoff. And just before we went on the air, I said, in my mind, I said, I'm going to elongate Here's. And of course, it caught on. That's become a big thing. The hi-yo happened one night when he was floundering and he needed something, and I went out of the blue. I just went, hi-yo!
Johnny Carson made me an overnight star. When you had just three networks, if somebody owned the audience at that network, you could be on the show for the first time, and by the next morning, everybody would know who you were. It's not possible to that extent anymore. So you went on one night, and by the next morning, everybody knew who you were. They'd say hello to you on the street. They would talk about Carson, because that was all people talked about at that time.
I said, you know, Johnny, the way the shows are going, they're so good, and the audiences are gigantic, and the guests are great. Do you really think this is the time to leave? And he said, you know something? I've always prided myself on my sense of timing. It's time to go.
Well, that was great. That's one of the great, you know, great days of my life. I always wanted, that's the job I always wanted, so to kind of get that was amazing to me.
Testing the public's appetite for more liberal programming, George Schlatter, producer and creator of Laugh-In, tells us about the program that revolutionized comedy on television when Television the First 50 Years continues.
Hey, Tommy, what's going on?
I'm trying out my new Dick Tracy Powell jet gun.
Made by Mattel.
Got his gritty perforated roll caps. They go in here, see?
That's not all. That shoots water, too.
Water?
Shoots about 30 feet.
Single shots are rapid fire. You can fire about 30 times before reloading.
Yeah, but Tommy.
See, here's where you put the water in.
I know.
You know.
I got one yesterday.
Why didn't you tell me?
What?
And ruin the commercial?
Get Mattel's new Dick Tracy Power Jet Gun, complete with target wherever toys are sold.
You can tell it's Mattel. It's where?
With their flashy heroes and cinematic styles, comic books quickly became a source for new television shows.
The Adventures of Superman.
One of the first successes was Superman, which starred George Reeves as the Man of Steel.
Kent State. Super Invincible.
Played for laughs, Batman, starring Adam West and Burt Ward, created a camp craze when it first appeared. The dynamic duo's most famous villains appeared from the comic pages, including the Penguin, the Joker, Catwoman, and the most popular of all, Frank Gorshin's Riddler.
And knock Batman and Robin out of the sky?
The Green Hornet soon followed, starring Van Williams and future global sensation Bruce Lee, seen here in his first American screen test.
You worked in motion pictures in Hong Kong?
Yes, since I was around 6 years old.
And when did you leave Hong Kong?
1959, when I was 18.
I see. Now look over to me, Bruce, as we talk. I understand you just had a baby boy?
Yeah.
And you've lost a little sleep over it, have you?
Three nights.
Show us some kung fu movements.
Although accidents do happen, but, you know, there are various kinds of strikes. It depends on where you hit and what weapon you will be using. To the eyes, you would use fingers. Don't worry. I will be. To the eyes, or straight at the face, from the waist, everything on.
Other comic book series included Wonder Woman and The Incredible Hulk. Lou Ferrigno speaks of the challenge in playing the not-so-jolly Green Giant.
It was a very big challenge at the beginning because with the white eyes and the teeth and that hideous face, to show the tremendous sensitivity behind it, especially getting the children to love the character, was the bigger challenge. And I've done it because I'm able to show pantomime very easily through the makeup. And this is the basic form of acting.
The Hulk's central premise was the theme of a man on the run, which was first used on a certified television classic, The Fugitive, which premiered on ABC in September 1963.
Richard Kimball ponders his fate as he looks at the world for the last time and sees only darkness. But in that darkness, fate moves its huge hand.
The 1967 final episode, where Kimball finally catches up with his wife's killer, was the highest-rated single television program ever broadcast, a record it would retain until 1976.
The Fugitive.
The best television actor by far of anybody was David Janssen. He died. He did The Fugitive. He was just a wonderful, wonderful television actor.
The influence of James Bond was felt on 60s television with such shows as The Avengers, exported from Bond's home country, England. At its height, this stylish and often funny series starred Patrick McNee and the stunning Diana Rigg as skilled agents John Steed and Emma Peel, and was originally filmed live.
Live. Can you imagine doing an adventure series? Well, everything happened. We had fights with villains on balconies and fell to our deaths five floors below. Then it had to be in the scene in a corridor with Honor Blackman or Diana Rigg. And the show, I think, got its name, The Avengers, because of the madness of those days. Then it developed through all these people until finally it became probably one of the best shows.
One, two.
Here at home, audiences thrilled to the super spy heroes of The Man from U.N.C.L.E., starring David McCallum and Robert Vaughn.
The U.N.C.L.E. show was the thing that made me go from being a working actor to being a negotiating actor. In other words, I had some clout after that. I could say I wanted this dressing room and more money and so on, better lunches, like that. It made a big difference in my life. And it was a big success throughout the world, even more so in the Orient and in England than it was in America.
Good morning, Mr. Phelps.
I got to be very fond of Jim Phelps and enjoyed playing him for many years, from about 67 to 73 or 4.
It was a wonderful time. We had a marvelous time shooting it. We knew we were doing something well, and everybody invested a great deal. So it was very special, and we are, in a certain sense, bound together in time, because that was our time doing that show, which clearly a very fine television show. No question.
First day on the set, I mean, it was astonishing because he was not only, we quickly knew he was very talented, very strong, very generous, and understood the show probably better than we did.
You know, it's been so great being a part of the cast of Mission Impossible, and it kind of set a precedent for the type of show we did. We were very different, and people seemed to like it. A lot of people thought that it was difficult for them to follow, but it was, I tell them, it was like a puzzle.
Science fiction was a popular choice among TV audiences, whether it was an anthology format or a thrilling space adventure. Rod Serling's Twilight Zone, and Night Gallery were programs that were usually moralistic and often quite frightening.
Sit quietly and we will control all that you see and hear.
The Outer Limits featured a different alien life form each week.
The Outer Limits.
And John Newland's One Step Beyond had a great hook. Many of its strange stories were supposedly based on true events.
What about the man who was so incredibly possessed by the soul of another long dead?
Star Trek was TV's most popular space adventure with the continuing voyages of the Starship Enterprise. Though the series did not do well during its original run on NBC, it went on to become a cult phenomenon.
Don't miss Star Trek in color.
I have done 612 television films, which represents a record, I think, which has never been broken. And of all of that, my Dr. Smith, which I created from the ground up, I say, with justifiable pride, is the winner. Who knew that it would become a worldwide classic? And that I, in my dotage, would become a classic hero.
I could go a lot faster if you'd carry some of this stuff.
Indeed, whatever is the younger generation coming to? When I was a young boy, I was eager to carry heavy loads, confident that the exercise would improve my muscles.
Billy's best kid actor in the whole world. And we worked like a team like you've never seen.
This plant, for instance, is similar to the cactus of Earth. However, it needs absolutely no moisture at all.
And where did you acquire this useless information, you tiresome thesaurus?
And Angela was, of course, a darling, lovely girl, still is. And pretty as a picture. She's married, two children, and Billy has two children.
Dr. Smith?
Yes.
What's that?
When a series is a hit, everybody in it is a hero. Everybody in it. Because we all get paid every Thursday. And when a series is a bomb, everybody in it is a bum because you're out of work the next week.
Other 1960s classics included the fondly remembered Andy Griffith Show. The child actor playing Andy's son, Opie, grew up to become one of Hollywood's hottest directors. His name, of course, is Ron Howard.
Andy would joke and carry on, but there was a time when the joking had to stop and it was time to do the work. And that, being able to make that turn, you know, from having fun and goofing around and then doing the job is a real important one because it makes the job fun. You enjoy that time that you're sitting around doing nothing. And then it also means that you get a lot out of the work. He was a great role model.
Comedies with a rural flavor were especially prevalent on CBS. They included The Beverly Hillbillies, Petticoat Junction, and one of the best, Green Acres, which starred Eddie Albert and Ava Gabor. Mr. Albert recalls the show fondly.
Everything was so beautifully put together. And comedic, and of course the casting was very good.
Petticoat Junction, Beverly Hillbillies, and Green Acres were responsible for about 10 years of television. I mean, the decade of the 60s.
Petticoat Junction.
There's a little hotel called the Shady Rest at the Junction.
I was under contract at Universal at the time, and I had to sneak out of my contract in order to go audition for it. And over 300 girls had auditioned for it. And when I went in there, apparently the girl that was supposed to be the original Billy Joe was taken off the show. And I sat in a room with Bea Benaderet, Edgar Buchanan, Paul Henning, and several other people, I can't remember at the moment, and they asked me to read with a southern accent from a Time magazine.
Come ride the little train that is rolling down the tracks to the junction.
I just got very lucky with getting Petticoat. It was my first real job that I got, and I was a drama major at UCLA. And then I went on to Hee Haw because they were interested in me because I'd been on Petticoat.
Forget about your cares, it is time to relax at the junction.
Petticoat Junction is based on my mother's real family. Her grandparents had a hotel right by this little spur line train track, and the traveling salesman would come and stay in the hotel, and so that's what he modeled it after.
Lots of curves, you bet, and even more when you get to the junction.
Petticoat Junction.
When all of his shows were taken off the air, as Pat Buttram said, CBS canceled every series with a tree in it.
When I was on Bewitched, I didn't watch Bewitched. It was actually on past my bedtime, and I thought it was more of a grown-up show. I worked with Dick York and Dick Sargent, 3 years with each. And they were wonderful, and I was fortunate that we actually stayed in touch after the show was over. So I was speaking with Dick York up until he passed away, and he really inspired me with his charitable spirit. And he was so sick. At the end, he had emphysema, and he was on oxygen and basically bedridden, but he was still constantly making phone calls, having mattresses donated to charity, having food donated to the homeless, and that really inspired me.
What are you, some kind of pervert?
I happen to be a complete heterosexual.
Any program capable of cajoling the President of the United States into saying, "Sock it to me," had to be an instant hit. And that's what Rowan and Martin's Laugh-In was when it debuted in 1968. Producer George Schlatter.
I remember when we were doing Laugh-In, the network did not understand what it was.
When I'm not.
You're not.
New in town, sailor.
And by the way, Laugh-In was the only show to ever test worse than Laugh-In was All in the Family.
Archie was so much like Ralph Cramden. In fact, I've borrowed freely from Jackie's style.
Hey, what's this?
What's it taste like?
Never mind what it tastes like. What is it?
Well, it's,
Go ahead, tell me. What is
it? It's a meatloaf.
I don't taste any meat.
Well, it's a vegetable meatloaf. You see, it's got chopped string beans, granulated carrots, shredded peas, spinach, and a whole lot of stuff. It's
got everything in it but meat.
I borrowed from Gleason, and I borrowed from Wallace Beery in a way, and a little from W.C. Fields. You know.
Their chemistry was so, brilliant. Emerson said, "We lie in the lap of a great intelligence, and we are simply receptors to its beams." I was a receptor. All these things came into my life, and I, you know, helped put them together.
There's no question, All in the Family, The Mary Tyler Moore Show, and The Bob Newhart Show were three of the most important.
Years with Bob Newhart were banner years for me. I admire him tremendously.
When I signed to do Emergency, I had never met Jack Webb before, and my agent called me and said that Jack Webb has decided that you're the only actor in town to play Dr. Brackett on a new series called Emergency. So I went in and I met Jack, and at that time I really was not interested in doing a medical show. I was still wanting to do another Western because I had done a couple Westerns in the past, Laramie and Wagon Train. And in 1971, Westerns were just about out and through, but that didn't deter me. I was bound and determined I was going to do another Western. And when I walked into Jack Webb's office, I said, I'd never met Jack before, and I said, "Mr. Webb, I appreciate the fact that you're interested in me to do this series, but I must tell you, I am not interested in doing a medical series." Jack looked at me and he said, "Shut up and sit down."
Emergency has changed everybody's perception of emergency medicine. I don't think anybody knew how important this show was going to be. I certainly didn't until now. Until I realize and I look around and I see all these people hanging on my every word, and I don't know why. I'm just an actor. I'm just a very lucky person to be involved with that show, and I'm very proud of it.
There isn't any place in the world that I go today that people don't come up to me and say, because of you, I'm a fireman. Because of you, I'm a paramedic. Because of you, I'm an EMT. And I love it when I see that, because these are great guys with a lot to offer to the world today. I'm very proud of them.
I'm scared. Your clothes. I told you to wear a morning coat. I wear this coat anymore.
Jack Klugman and I are like brothers. It again proved one of the turning points in my life, because I made so much money from it that I was able to do what I wanted with the rest of my life. What I wanted to do was have a classical repertory theater. And my income from The Odd Couple gave me the freedom to do what I wanted.
It was a situation where a character evolved. A very good actor named Henry Winkler came along in a situation where he was able to create this phenomena, and to try to stymie that would be real destructive.
I was always worried about what he was thinking, because it was his show, and then all of a sudden this new guy comes in and his character takes off, you know. Ronnie never once made me think about it. He never once gave me cause to think that I might be uncomfortable in this situation.
It was never really the problem for me that it seemed to be for a lot of other people.
The one reason I never did my own series and I stayed on Happy Days is because I would never find another acting partner like Ronnie. What means something is the fact that each creation you make, each character you create, is a painting on the wall. And you better do that to the perfection, or the closest to the perfection that your body can eke out of itself.
ABC had seen an audition that I did. It was the part of the girlfriend for the Fonz, Henry Winkler's character in Happy Days. And when I auditioned for it, I was totally wrong for the part in terms of how I looked. Everybody there was like really bombshelly, and I was short and, you know, heavy and whatever at that time. But they liked my work, and they wanted to find a show for me to do. And so Three's Company was one of the shows that they sent me to take a look at during that period of time. And it's the one I ended up picking. And they picked me, too. It's not like I just got to pick, you know.
We made each other laugh a lot. We got silly, which you need when you're doing a show, you know. It just loosens you up. And it made us act better, I think, and to be funnier. And it went on and on and on, and we had the best times.
Like in any relationship, there are those moments where things are less than ideal, but on the Three's Company set and in that working circumstance, it was very rare. Most of the time, it was just nuts and total fun.
Another show that made us laugh extended the sitcom theme of family structure to include co-workers. WKRP in Cincinnati centered around a close-knit group of friends working at a radio station.
I think you'd be really great. I'd like you to read the role of Herb Tarlick, the sales manager of WKRP. And I had read the script quickly out in the waiting room and said, you know, the truth is I'm really only interested in the disc jockey. Definitely feel an affinity for this guy, John Caravella, this disc jockey. Was so confused that he can't even remember his on-air name. I think this interview gives proof to that. So I read for the role of Herb, and I also read for the role of Johnny. And as I was leaving the office, he said, now, you're really serious. If we offered you Herb, you wouldn't do it. And I thought for a split second and said, that's correct. I'm really only interested in the disc jockey.
Mannix, Beretta, Kojak. I was always the Puerto Rican with the gun, the knife, the brick, you know? The stereotypical Hispanic American villain. And then, of course, Chips changed that image to be on a series and to be in people's homes every week for an hour. They would actually turn the TV on, turn on to the channel you were on. That's an invitation. Hey, come on over, Eric, for an hour. So that's why I always jump all over my fans. Hi, how are you? Take a picture with me, you know? I do that to them. Because if they're so kind enough to invite me into their home for an hour a week for 6 years, like on Chips, and the success of it, the least I could do is say, hey, thank you.
The late 1970s also brought realistic family dramas with programs like Eight is Enough, which starred Dick Van Patten as a newspaper reporter with real-life family problems. Dick Van Patten remembers.
ABC
That was the network. They put me under contract. And so as soon as the show went off the air, they put me into two pilots. They put me into one called The Love Boat. And in the same month, April of 1976, they put me into a pilot called Eight Is Enough. And then they both sold. So now they didn't know which one to keep me in, you know? So I didn't particularly care. I liked both shows. But they decided to keep me in Eight Is Enough, and they recast the part in The Love Boat. Now, the Eight Is Enough was on for 5 years. Love Boat was on for 10 years, so I was probably better off with Love Boat. But anyway, I think Eight Is Enough was a classy show. I was very happy to do it.
The 1980s saw programs come and go at a quick rate.
Turn around here and get this picture. I love this person.
But a few of them caught on and became blockbusters, including the late-night soap, Dallas.
I knew the show was going to be a success. It had the chance to be, because there's a lot of good shows that come on that have bad spots, and they're up against a lot of tough other shows. A lot of competition. And so we snuck in there. Golly, we were on Monday nights and Sunday nights and Saturday nights and Friday nights, and they shuffled us around until we found a good niche on a Friday night.
I love what I do, and it's a definite challenge, a definite responsibility for me. I have to keep it fresh. You know, I look at the people on Broadway who do the same play for 7 years and running, you know, and they say the same words for 7 years. I don't think I've ever worked with a more talented or really supportive, loving group before. I mean, they're really extraordinary.
I just think we're such a good team, and we're very supportive of one another. Everybody on the show really cares about their work. No one walks off and leaves you to talk to a script person when it's your turn to be on camera. Everybody stays and fills in.
Television in the 90s gave us more channels and more choices. Just because a show flopped on a network did not mean it was dead. Baywatch, for example, after being canceled by NBC, flourished in syndication and became a worldwide hit.
They're all challenged a lot. I think Mike Newman is challenged acting-wise. He's challenged every day. He's growing as an actor. He's becoming very, very good. He doesn't need to get any better physically. He's spectacular. Nobody is as good in the water as he is. Pam Anderson is challenged to do the physical stuff, but she does beautifully. Her acting skills are fantastic.
We do a lot of things that will involve using lifeguards, you know, where I'll be on some sort of rescue on land and I have to jump onto a boat. I say, call Baywatch, and then hopefully Newman will be the guy coming in to help me make that safe.
I think they're going to pan, right?
Although cable has provided more choices for the discerning viewer, the old networks and studios are still going strong. A whole new generation of stars are making their marks in the media and will most likely continue to do so for television's next 50 years.
I wouldn't want to be young these days in the business and have to go through what the young men and women do now. It's hard out there because you have a lot of people who are running the business that are just businessmen and businesswomen. The creativity is gone sometimes, a lot of the times. It's just out there making the buck. But every now and then, something worthwhile comes through and you keep your own integrity.
I have absolutely no interest in doing television films. I gave it up about 7 years ago because I found that I no longer wanted to work with what I had to work with. I'm sorry. And suddenly I said, I spend my time waiting around for them to light. Okay, I'm used to that. It's a way of life. And then finally you get to play a scene with someone who doesn't know what they're doing. And NBC says they're a star. Get lost. I quit.
The broadcast of many of today's programs is made possible by the members of PBS 45 and 49.
and by the Home Savings and Loan Company. Serving the Mahoning Valley since 1889, Home Savings and Loan is a subsidiary of United Community Financial Corp. Member FDIC, Equal Opportunity Lender.